you.
It's been a little while.
Yeah.
Well, there.
Everything will be.
Actually, I came to the board meeting.
Oh, yeah, you're at the board meeting.
I think when I called, I kept my distance. I thought everyone was over there. And then you guys, they hung around afterwards. So, all good.
Let me get my name tag.
Yep, Kathy Brister.
Hi, Nydia.
Good morning, Kathy.
How are you?
I'm doing very well.
Thank you. Good morning.
I'm sorry, you're going to have to tell me your name again.
Dana.
Dana. We met. You were at Welcome, right? Did you work
with her? I have in the past.
I don't think she did this last year.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I don't think so.
You look familiar. I think we've met at some point.
I'm sure that you have.
Good morning. My name is Richard Griffiths. I'm a Georgia First Amendment Foundation board member. And I'd like to welcome everybody to the 32nd Bar, Media, and Judiciary Conference. It's the third year that the conference is presented with the organizational support of the foundation. This conference was originally conceived by some judges and journalists as a way to get real conversations going between those justices and journalists and lawyers that don't always see eye to eye. The goal was to help all three groups better understand the others, their motivations, and also the political, judicial, and legal challenges they face and the state of Georgia faces. We have a really terrific program for the day. For the full rundown, you can go to the QR code or type in the bit.ly and get the rundown. You can get the bios, and you can get the additional supplemental materials, which there's quite a bit. We will have a working lunch today, and we'll let you know when those box lunches are in, so you can go get yours before all of the vegetarian ones or the ones with extra mustard disappear. I also want to remind everybody that there will be a reception at the end of the day, a good opportunity for some networking, good opportunity to meet the organizers and tell us what we should do better for next year, and your fellow participants. My big job today is going to try to keep the trains running on time and trying to make sure we are keeping somewhat close to the schedule, particularly around lunchtime. We've got a taping with WABE, and so we need to be really precise about that time. And so if we ask you to get back to your seats, please get back to your seats. Now I want to talk about the sponsors whose contributions go so far as to support this conference. The names are now on the screen: the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, CNN, big sponsor, the State Bar of Georgia, which gives us enormous support in setting up this conference, and the space, and your parking. So thanks very much to the State Bar and to Jones Day. And you see the other many generous sponsors on that list. This conference would not have been pulled together if it was not for the tireless work of the volunteers that you see on the screen. It's a lot of volunteers. A lot of hard work goes into this conference. I want to especially thank Peter Canfield from Jones Day, who patiently guides this committee through the preparation of this event. Now we'll turn to the kickoff panel of the conference.
I'm going to get back to it before the start.
Okay.
Thank you.
be more complimentary anyways.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the panel Reporting on the Courts, a new frontier which will run from 10 to 10:50 this morning. My name is Jonathan Peters. I'm a media law professor at the University of Georgia, where I teach media law in both the law school and the journalism program. I'm also the chair of the Department of Journalism there and the vice president of the board of directors of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. The legendary journalist Lyle Denniston, who covered the Supreme Court and other courts more than 55 years for outlets as diverse as the Wall Street Journal, the American Lawyer, and SCOTUS blog, he wrote a book a number of years ago titled The Reporter and the Law. He commented in one chapter that if journalism is the contemporary history of conflict, and often it is, the courtroom can and will be a place of intense fascination to the journalist. Whatever else the law may be, when it is at work in court, it is conflict done up in gentle person's garb, but conflict nonetheless. That, at least, is the way the legal reporter will treat it most of the time. Supreme Court Justice William O. Douglas, likely intending to be disparaging more than analytical, once described the perspective of the legal reporter this way. Quote, journalists are primarily interested in the story of one judge letting the air out of another judge's tire, or when a judge throws an inkwell. There's probably some truth in that, and as Lyle wrote later in his book, in a court of law, there are winners and losers, and it's the task of legal reporting to tell who won or lost. It is also the task to describe how the process went and the result was reached. It's well to remember that the court is a people's tribunal that helps to teach a community about basic right and wrong, and its processes and results must be conveyed beyond the courthouse. Recent years have seen many, many such processes and results conveyed. You might have watched yesterday as South Carolina lawyer Alex Murdoch took the stand and admitted that he lied to investigators and stole from clients. Or before that, you might have followed the Johnny Depp Amber Heard defamation litigation, or the trial and conviction of three men for the killing of 25-year-old black man Ahmaud Arbery. Then there was the Supreme Court's decision in Dobbs v. Jackson, reversing Roe v. Wade, and the stunning leak of a draft majority opinion. The voting technology companies Dominion and Smartmatic are making headlines every week in their multi-billion dollar libel litigation against Fox News and claims that the network aired verifiably false statements about their products and services. There have been dozens of highly charged and publicized cases stemming from the 2020 elections, including, of course, the special purpose grand jury selected in Fulton County for the investigation into efforts to overturn Georgia's results. The list goes on, and it underscores not only the public interest in court activities, but also the importance of clear and deeply reported journalism about the courts. At a time when there is a growing public perception of the courts as political. To help us explore these and other issues, we're joined by five panelists with experience and expertise that are both extensive and quite different. Judge Robert McBurney has served on the Superior Court of Fulton County since 2012. Keeping a very low profile that entire time.
Until today.
He survived a stint as chief judge from 2018 to 2020, and he is one of two drug court judges there, a role that allows him to help people retake control of lives lost to addiction. Before joining the bench, Judge McBurney served as an assistant U.S. attorney in Atlanta, where he focused on cases involving public corruption, terrorism, and child exploitation. He received both his BA and JD from Harvard. Tamar Hallerman is a senior reporter for the Atlanta Journal-Constitution. She is the paper's lead reporter covering the Fulton County investigation. Along with her reporting partner, Bill Rankin, she co-hosts the ninth season of AJC's Breakdown podcast, which also focuses on the Fulton investigation. Hallerman was previously the AJC's Washington correspondent and spent nearly a decade on Capitol Hill writing for various media outlets. She is a native of Blacksburg, Virginia, and attended American University. Kathleen Joyner is the public information officer of the Supreme Court of Georgia. She started that role in 2021 after the retirement of veteran PIO Jane Hansen. Joyner is a former marketing communications director for two units at Georgia State University. And she was a journalist for the Daily Report in Atlanta, where she covered the General Assembly, the State AG's office, the DeKalb County Courts, and more. She also worked for the Clarion Ledger in Mississippi and the Chattanooga Times Free Press in Tennessee. She is an alumna of the back-to-back national champion, University of Georgia. Mark Sherman, I'm actually contractually obligated to mention that. We have Mark Sherman, who has covered the U.S. Supreme Court for the AP since 2006, and he has been with the AP since 2001. He has previously written about the Justice Department, healthcare, and politics in nearly 35 years as a reporter based in Washington and in Atlanta. Sherman earlier worked for the AJC, starting the same week as the Democratic National Convention in 1988. He covered the end of Andy Young's time as mayor, then state and national politics. He is a native of Brooklyn and a graduate of Princeton. Then we have Richard Vining. He is an associate professor in the Department of Political Science at the University of Georgia, and he received his doctorate from Emory University in Atlanta. His research focuses on judicial selection and turnover, judicial decision-making and administration, as well as the interaction of courts with external institutions, including the press. His forthcoming book, Examining the State Chief Justices, is due later this year from the University of Michigan Press. Now, against that background, let's get into the discussion, and I'd like to begin with Richard and a general question about news coverage of the courts. So, Richard, what do the fields of political science and communication studies tell us about which court activities are likely to receive attention from the news media?
All right, well, thank you for having me here today. So I was thinking about this question on the way in because during my drive-in from Athens, I had Morning Edition on, right? And the one court-related case they covered was the current Texas lawsuit, right? Challenging abortion medications and the FDA approval of them 20-odd years ago. And that article really emphasized, or that piece on NPR really emphasized that it was a Trump-appointed judge, right, talking about what was at stake. And that made me think about a lot of these factors that the literature often does cite as being influential in determining which court actions, which court activities actually draw attention from the press, right? So top-line stuff, I guess, that won't surprise anybody in here, right? Courts get a lot less coverage, of course, than the other two branches of government, right? That's obvious. Something else that's really, again, kind of fundamental to understand, coverage of courts does not in any way, shape, or form provide a representative set, right, of the events that take place in courtrooms. The public is only going to be exposed to a certain basket of items that are probably going to influence the way they think about what courts, judges, and lawyers do. And that basket of items is heavily weighed generally toward events that are controversial, dramatic, have great impact on law, politics, and society. Often the media will focus on things that come from the geographic area, right, where that media is located, so that's not surprising perhaps, but does sort of help drive choices on that side of things. Familiarity is also very important. So mentioned Amber Heard and Johnny Depp, right? Cases that involve celebrities, major politicians, people like that are very likely to draw attention from the press, right? Versus those that involve ordinary human beings like most of us in the world. Cases that involve novelty, very common, right? Things that are unusual and make the news. There's new challenges, new ways the law is being driven, new or breathtaking, groundbreaking ideas people come up with to try to challenge legal principles. You know, those things can find their way into coverage of the courts. And of course, scandal. You mentioned, of course, those quotes from Justice Douglas. I don't think that kind of thing would be, of course, that surprising to see in our news. You know, the Wisconsin Supreme Court, for example, has been in the news recently. Well, only a few years ago it was in the news because one of the justices strangled or threatened another, right? This is terrible. And that sort of thing makes national news when that happens. So, you know, these sorts of things really do help us understand which news events become news items, become news content in the end. And of course, we can't really overlook the profit motive. Most media is a for-profit enterprise, so they're trying to generally publish things, right, that will attract readers or viewers, right, news consumers. They need an audience. And presumably that audience and securing them helps them sell advertising and helps them continue as an operating business. So the communication and poli-sci literature really has focused a lot on kind of characteristics of cases that might fit some of those molds I've talked about, as well as looking at things like how the media and journalism business and the needs of it being a business also help drive coverage. So those sorts of things are very common. If we're thinking about what kinds of cases get covered, again, probably not shocking to hear, right? High profile cases involving civil rights, civil liberties, criminal justice, right? That's very, very common. Especially those that do involve some kind of surprising outcome or something that really draws the attention of the public. Now, think of a death penalty case where a conviction is overturned, right? I mean, that's something the public is going to be very interested in, and the media will generally report that relative to other death penalty cases where something like that does not happen. So that's a very common sort of pattern we do see. I can also tell you that the literature finds quite definitively there is, sadly, very little coverage of appellate courts below the U.S. Supreme Court. So if you're really interested in what's happening at intermediate appellate courts or state high courts, hard to find that information most of the time. Probably an issue that's exacerbated with the decline in recent years of local beat reporters who were covering local courts because of staff cuts and sort of consolidation of media. So we have seen a definite drop in that. I've got a paper right now under review that shows basically since the late 90s, coverage of state courts has just been like a playground slide. Like it has just really bottomed out, hit a plateau. And I don't see any way we come back from that. So at this point, it's very clear the volume of coverage is much lower as the business of journalism has also changed. I can also tell you that there are very clear gatekeeping effects. Once a case gets coverage somewhere, especially in a major outlet, that does increase the odds it's going to be covered later on. But for those that don't get covered at the trial stage, very little odds that's ever going to catch the attention of journalists later on as time goes by, unless something really amazing happens that catches the media's eye. And I guess the last thing I'll mention, because it was in the blurb for this panel, lots of attention, of course, to judicial selection items in the press these days. Now, in a state like Georgia, where we don't typically have very controversial judicial elections, they're not getting a lot of attention. But I can tell you, of course, in other states, that's very different. Our neighbors in Alabama, for example, have clearly been very sick of seeing news about their Supreme Court for 20 years during election cycles, because it's been very, very controversial from time to time. federal judicial selection, of course, that draws all kinds of attention. And if we're concerned about how that politicizes the courts, how that makes the public think of them in a particular way, that's a real thing, right? And as we've seen very high profile Supreme Court picks that sort of flavor the way people think about the courts generally, and you do see these very controversial processes play out in the national news for months at a time, you know, scandalous allegations, hard-fought politics, right? The timing of the Gorsuch and Garland and Barrett nominations, like that also made those political. You know, those are also things that really do sort of, again, make the public think of the courts maybe as a little more of a political item than they might prefer to be perceived as. But those are some general trends we do see in the literature.
Thank you, Richard. Mark, I'd like to go to you now on the question of judicial selection. In recent years, as Richard just mentioned, Supreme Court nominations and confirmations have generated a huge amount of media attention and public interest. Those of Justices Kavanaugh and Barrett were must-see TV. They galvanized people all around the country. How has the confirmation process changed? And what have those changes meant for media coverage of the Supreme Court and for public perceptions of it?
Well, first of all, thank you for having me. I guess I would say first, can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
I would say first that it's sort of entirely unsurprising to me that as our culture has become more politicized and the split is ever firmer, that the same thing has shown up in the judicial selection process. So that there was a ton of coverage when Sandra Day O'Connor was chosen for the Supreme Court, but of course it's not of the same nature. What is different today is that for the past 10 or so years, the ideology of the justices and the political affiliation of the justices matches perfectly. It didn't used to be the case. There used to be conservative-leaning justices appointed by Democratic presidents and liberal-leaning justices appointed by Republicans. That's no longer the case, and the reason it's no longer the case is because of this increasing polarization. There's no reward for a president to pick someone who's sort of middle of the road. His own base won't tolerate that. We saw, for instance, when Merrick Garland was nominated, not that this would necessarily matter to the outcome, but while no one certainly opposed him on the Democratic side, there was no great groundswell of support for him. I mean, very, very accomplished, very well-respected at the time appellate judge, but he didn't excite the liberal interest groups in the way that, say, Ketanji Brown Jackson did when she was nominated. What that has meant for coverage of the court is that it's inescapable that when we write stories about the court, I think as reporters are obligated to say that this block of conservative justices, all appointed by Republican presidents, has voted one way and the liberals have voted the other. You know, it's a sort of, I think, a bit of a vicious cycle because you know, there are always complaints from the judiciary that we do make that connection. But the reality is that there's a connection there to be made. For instance, justices always love to tell you how many of their opinions are unanimous, and that it's the vast majority of all the cases they decide. The suggestion there is that, of course, we in the press are magnifying the fewer cases where they're at odds. Well, last term was the first term in a long time where there are actually more 6-3 decisions than there were unanimous decisions. So, I guess I'll stop there.
Kathleen, I'd like to go to you next. You have the job of communicating on behalf of the Supreme Court of Georgia and otherwise serving as a link between the court and the press and public, all in a highly politically charged environment. How do you perform those roles, especially in high-profile cases?
Yeah, so I think like Professor Vining mentioned, my job is to make sure that you all, whether it's media, lawyers, or the general public, know what is happening at the Supreme Court, that you understand their actions, their decisions, and that you have access to those in the proceedings as well. My job, I think, is a lot less more outside of the political realm. I'm not a political scholar. I don't really dabble in that area. But I do try to serve up kind of equitable access to our court's proceedings, oral arguments, our court's opinions, news and announcements about the court. But I do pay particular attention to things that I think that our media contacts would be interested in, because you all also are a conduit of that information. You know, it's funny, part of my job too is civics education. So I take a lot of tour groups and civic groups on tours, and there's always the question of, like, what's the most important case you've ever had? And that really depends on who you talk to, because to the parties in that case, that is the most important case that we are deciding. So it's not my job to tell you what's the most important case, but I do pay attention to what is getting coverage, so that if there is an opinion in that case, I provide a summary. But there are also cases that maybe don't get a lot of media coverage that may be of interest, may be important. You know, they're overturning precedent or something else is happening. It's an interpretation of the Constitution that we haven't had, you know, that question come up before. So what I try to do is make sure that in every way possible, there is access. So we publish all of our opinions. Our oral arguments are live streamed, and they have been before the pandemic, but that turns out came in super handy. And so in that way, you know, I try to convey what I can, but I do pay attention to, I think, what our reporters are asking me for in particular.
Terrific. And Judge McBurney, back in October, AJC columnist Bill Torpy wrote that, quote, "It seems the most contentious cases in Georgia have a common denominator, and it's you." he went on to note recent high-profile cases in which you've been involved, including a challenge to Georgia's restrictive abortion law, and of course the special purpose grand jury. Yeah, these were high-profile cases covered to some extent in political terms. Are there any steps that judges can take to depoliticize their proceedings?
No. No, there are, but first, I appreciate the idea about letting air out of colleagues' tires. I may have a couple who have lower rides this evening when they head out. There are, and it's a focus on why we're in the courtroom, as opposed to some of the issues that partisans and, frankly, reporters want to inject into the proceedings. Sometimes, even though the subject matter is of great political interest, the legal issue is pretty dry and maybe obscure. What does void ab initio mean? That's what the Sister Song case was all about when I was dealing with it. What does that mean? And does a law that when it was passed was unconstitutional, arguably, under a then existing Supreme Court standard, does it persist after that Supreme Court standard changes? That's it. It wasn't about the rights of women or unborn, and people can try to inject that, but I think judges can work to make sure that when we're in court, we're focused on the legal reasons for being in court and not the political reasons. And it's easier said than done, but if you have litigators who are serious about their work and you have a judge who asserts herself at the beginning, this is what we're here about, and doesn't put up with nonsense of, well, I'm going to get to the legal issue, but first I have to pound my chest for a while about the social importance of this. All of which may be true, but we're not taking a poll in the courtroom. We're going to figure out, what does the law say, how is that law applied, and what are the consequences of how that law is applied. And again, easier said than done, but I know that my colleagues and I, when we do get cases that are going to attract media attention, we do try to establish up front that what's going on in court is focused on the law and not maybe some of the hubbub that people want to interject into it.
Now how do you try to establish that? What do you specifically do?
Well, one thing I can do is interrupt. So if someone gets up and starts taking us away from what the legal issues are, I can say that's not what I'm really interested in talking about. But even better than interrupting, I like to frame things at the beginning. So everyone is seated and there's a call to order. I acknowledge the importance of what we're talking about. I let everyone in the audience know that they're welcome to be here, but if they can't be here in a quiet and respectful way, they need to step outside. I've already talked to my deputies to be ready to get people outside if they're going to hiss or cheer. This is not a UGA game. There will be no cheering or sobbing if you're a TCU fan. We are here to focus on the issues. And so if the judge frames it up front, this is what we're here to talk about. And what I'm interested in is hearing your view, Mr. Solicitor, and your view, Madam Counsel, on void ab initio. Talk to me about that. And this isn't the time to talk about the unborn or this or that. Go out on the courthouse steps and talk about that. But here, we're focused on the legal issues. Lawyers tend, not all, but most lawyers tend to say, okay, you've given an instruction, I will follow that instruction. And they're good at pushing boundaries, and judges are good at pushing back and reinforcing those boundaries. But if you frame the issue up front, here's what we're gonna talk about. I have found in my several situations you described that by and large, the lawyers stick to it. It's harder once you get a witness on the stand, because witnesses, they like to go here and there, and lawyers are good at saying, well, what do you think about this? Oh, that's a dangerous question. And then they run with it, and it's not my job to interrupt the witnesses, but at least with the lawyers, judges have a good ability, if they take advantage of it, to frame the issue that is before the court legally as opposed to politically.
Now, Tamar, you're new to covering the courts. You came from the world of Washington politics. How has your D.C. training impacted, if at all, the way that you have covered the Fulton DA's investigation?
It's certainly been interesting. My years on Capitol Hill, I was covering a lot of the judicial confirmation fights between Mitch McConnell and Harry Reid in the Senate, using the nuclear option to get rid of the filibusters first for lower level judicial picks, and then all the way up to the Supreme Court. So Merrick Garland, all of those fights that came after, and now the degradation of the blue slip process that looks like it's on the way out as well. So I came from that world of constant political spin, and you're right, I've never covered the judicial system in Georgia here, and for a while it seemed like, oh, this is kind of nice, we're a little bit out of that realm. But as I've been covering the special grand jury process, it's amazing how much politics has started to seep in. And of course, I know Judge McBurney is doing everything he can to make sure that doesn't happen. Things that have been really helpful to me, having judges like Judge McBurney who can explain the law carefully and in a really accessible way has been immensely helpful to me. Having colleagues, old veterans like Bill Rankin, my reporting partner, who can masterfully explain statute in a way that your average human can understand. And then I think for me, what's been really important is kind of taking the time before I walk into a courtroom to read all the legal briefs, to hopefully talk to the lawyers who've written them ahead of time, to kind of understand what they're going to say before they say it, so that when the circus comes to town after the hearing, I can kind of be prepared to frame all the issues at hand. But it's been an absolute challenge, and this week has been the perfect testament to that. We saw the forewoman of the special grand jury speak publicly, give a series of interviews, including to the AJC, and we've gotten all sorts of responses from people on social media, including folks who are saying, why are you giving people these 15 minutes of fame? This is a very somber exercise. Why are you doing this? You're hurting the investigation. Don't you care? Oh, she's a Trump plant. And I've just tried to kind of stay out of it as much as I can, but it's pretty darn impossible in this day and age to take politics out of the equation, especially when you're talking about such high profile things as former presidents and people who worked in the White House.
Judge McBurney, I would be remiss if I did not ask, do you have any public response to the statements made by the foreperson?
So I don't think it'd be appropriate for me to respond directly. I think it's important for people to understand that the grand jurors took an oath, and that oath requires the grand jurors to maintain in confidence, keep secret, their deliberations, full stop. That's the extent of their oath.
You heard it here first. So Tamar, a follow-up question for you. What kind of reader feedback have you gotten in response to your coverage?
Everything, anything and everything, and especially this last week was such a reminder of that. I've gotten accused that I'm helping the Trump people, I've gotten accused that I'm helping the DA, that I'm shielding all these different people or not holding the right people to account, and it's just been anything and everything. And I've tried to kind of explain my role as a journalist, which is, you know, I'm not here to protect anyone. I'm gonna try and explain what the law is as best I can. I'm gonna try and summarize as faithfully as I can what all these different people are saying, what all these different sides are saying, and make sure I give folks, you know, different stakeholders the opportunity to comment. But, you know, we have interests as media. You know, I'm not here to protect different people. I don't want people to, you know, break the law, but I'm also not here to be anyone's friend or to help anybody accomplish a goal.
Terrific. Richard, I want to go back to you for another big picture question here. What do we know about the consequences of the shift from traditional news outlets to digital and other non-traditional news outlets in terms of coverage of the courts?
Yeah, this has been a really interesting thing to watch happen in real time. I finished grad school in 08, and during the time I was at Emory, and then in the time I've been over at UGA now, sort of watched the entire way that I read about news and cover them transition, really. So I started doing some research on this, and I've got a grad student right now who's doing some really great stuff in this area. It looks like probably the most obvious results I can tell you, kind of basic findings. If you look at kind of higher level appellate courts and how often they're covered, how much coverage they're getting, now that we have transitioned from the world of traditional or legacy media into digital media, courts get less coverage. That may be surprising because the former constraints associated with kind of the size of the news hole and page space are largely eliminated, right? The idea you have 22 minutes of airtime to fill or just a number of column inches that was sort of able to handcuff traditional media forever, those aren't really there for websites that have infinite scrolling or for Twitter where you can post all the time. You know, you have character limits, but otherwise you can post as often or whatever as you feel like. I mean, ask Elon Musk, right? You can post all day.
Don't ask Elon.
Yeah, I guess so. That's why you're the judge and I'm not. But it looks like when they do provide coverage in these digital outlets, the general trend is that compared to the coverage we have gotten historically, or even in present day, in print or legacy media, the digital media focus much more on the politicized, the dramatic, the controversial, rather than giving even anything resembling kind of overall picture of what's happening in courts. They are going to focus, at least from my research, much more on things like judicial selection than what's actually happening in the courts. They're not actually going to focus as much on things like cert grants or petitions or oral arguments as you would find in traditional media. So there's kind of a decline in quality if you look to the digital coverage versus the long-standing traditional media's coverage. Something else that probably drives that, though, is that those outlets tend to have less expertise, I would argue, right, in terms of courts coverage. They don't have beat reporters there. They're often probably just getting AP wire stories and not really doing any other searching for information because they just don't have a lot of staff, right? Because we're in this world where the digital media are run often by just a handful of kind of people. You know, you may have some site like the Drudge Report or something where it's a sole person or a small team of people that are curating all the content, really. And they have a large audience, right? Something else that is pretty clear, though, that may be a possible silver lining is that the emergence of social media as a place for journalists to disseminate news about courts does seem to provide a much fuller picture of what courts actually do. So while websites are really kind of, in my mind, somewhat disappointing in the way they're covering courts, social media is providing a much fuller image of what they do. Now, it may be more likely to have a bias to it, or it may be less nuanced, right, or very short, especially if you're looking at a, you know, character limit on Twitter or something. But it looks like, you know, websites, we might be able to tell a different story than social media. But either way, the coverage generally online is just lower quality than the coverage you have from traditional media, which is probably unfortunate since many people have moved their primary news consumption to online news.
Now, Judge McBurney, on the subject of digital media, you have a Facebook page and a YouTube account where you provide live feeds and most of your proceedings. So two related questions for you. One of them, how should judges manage their social media presence? And then the other one, why do you provide live feeds of most of your proceedings?
So the first answer is simple. There is a static Facebook page that my wife put together when I was first running for office. And I don't know that it's been updated content-wise. I don't know how to find it. I am not a Facebooker. I do not have a Twitter account, any of that. And I think for good reason. I don't think judges should be in the social media stratosphere. Judge McFadden has a colleague who could come up here and talk for hours, Judge Dillard, about how he has a contrary view. I think for trial judges, it's deadly. You can't, there's not a way you could respond to something that gets posted on your social media platform that wouldn't be commenting on what's in front of you. And it just, it's not practical. So I have learned from my wife, who checked the Facebook page recently, that people are sharing their views on how George Soros and I share our vacations together because of the decisions I made. Never met the guy, but I think it is problematic for judges to be active in social media. It is too unconstrained a space, and it is too easy for a judge, and I'm now putting on my Judicial Qualifications Commission hat, it is too easy for a judge to make intentionally or unintentionally a misstep, and that judge appears to have been commenting on a matter before her. And that is rule two after don't lie, cheat, and steal as a judge would be don't comment on matters that are in front of you. And we just see that in the JQC all the time for those judges who are active with social media, which I'm not. It's the second question I'm much more interested in, and I don't know that it's so much I have a YouTube channel as every judge in Fulton County during the pandemic was given the ability to provide live feeds of proceedings. We had to constitutionally. Once we were able to set court back up again, we wanted to move forward. We had to provide public access to what we were doing. And the easy way to do that was, because we were having Zoom sessions, was to push that Zoom feed through a YouTube feed so that anyone could see what's going on in court in Fulton County. You could be in Texas, you could be in Tasmania, and you could be watching what's going on in court. And I think that's an amazing thing. I think this notion of a people's tribunal is exactly what's going on here. It allows immediate access to everything that's going on. It helps keep the judges behaving because there's always a camera running, but it gives people an ability to see what's going on when they otherwise might not be able to. If you were the victim of a burglary, but you're not interested in coming to court because you moved on with your life, you could watch the plea. You don't need to be in the courtroom with a person who broke into your house so that he could see you and know what you look like. But you could watch the proceedings. You could see what the judge did, hold the judge accountable. So I have found that people are plugging into what we might find is not covered in the statistics you're gathering, because it's not the media, it's the people who are able to watch it. And so people tell me that with this YouTube channel, people are able to comment, and there are actually folks who follow proceedings, and not just hearing on a special purpose grand jury or the Sister Song case, but a murder trial, that there are classes that will watch because they can see real time. Here's what's going on in court. This is what lawyers actually do. It's not what you see on CSI, but this is a real live court. So some of my colleagues have stepped back from the YouTube feed now that the courthouse is open, but I encourage them, when they're willing to listen, to keep that going, because it is the people's tribunal. And as a product of federal court, where the only images I ever saw of myself were these funny drawings from the court sketch artist that made me look like half duck, half bat. And I just remember early on in my time there, Eric Rudolph was being sentenced. This guy tried to blow up the Olympics, and there were no cameras. There were no cameras for this guy's plea and sentencing. And that, my humble opinion, is crazy. And I think that the public should have access to something as momentous as that, and as minor as a landlord-tenant battle in my courtroom. They ought to be able to see it without having to come to court. So it's C-SPAN, but it would be J-SPAN, you know, judiciary viewing. People ought to be able to see it. There's nothing wrong with it, and whatever warts are in the system, people should be able to see that as well if they're going to make informed decisions. As long as we elect judges, it's the best way to learn about them, because you're certainly not going to read about judges, because there's a lot of stories about a judge who doesn't happen to have a high-profile case.
Can I just add that, you know, obviously at the Supreme Court, the justices have long been opposed to cameras, and even those who say when they're being confirmed that they'd be open to the idea end up changing their minds. But of course, the pandemic changed a lot in terms of access to the courts. And so now, as you know, court proceedings are available, at least the audio, to anyone who wants to listen. So it's not just the few hundred of us who are in the room, but everyone around the country. And that has had an effect, and we're still kind of seeing how it shakes out, but that's had an effect on reporting about the court, because you don't have to wait for my story anymore to know what happened at the argument. And if I could just say just about social media at the Supreme Court, none of the justices is on social media in terms of being identified, but it's pretty clear that some of them were. We know this because they've almost said so. I mean, even just the other day, Amy Coney Barrett in a case was talking about, with, you know, great ease about, you know, retweets and likes, and it's pretty clear. I mean, she's the mother of, you know, school-age kids. It's not that much of a surprise. But there's several of them who are clearly on social media, even if they don't have their own accounts on Judge Dillard's.
Can I weigh in too? So, as Professor Biding was saying, there may be less coverage of state courts as well, and I think just from my personal view, that's why it's so imperative for us to have the live stream of our oral argument to make those proceedings public and more accessible. We talk about access to justice. You know, I used to be a reporter in a past life, and so I empathize with the increase in content demand, the short deadlines, the immediacy of reporting, and so I hope in some way that also gives not just the public but our media contacts greater access, so that when you're doing six things at once, you can keep an eye on what our court is doing and have that feed to report from accurately. So
if I could add in too. I mean, as somebody who's new to covering the courts, being able to record what's going on in the room has been immensely helpful to me, because I'm handling a lot of these issues for the first time. And if you go into a federal courthouse, it happens in a blur. As Kathleen says, you're doing six things at once. Sometimes like, wait, what did that lawyer say about an hour in? That was really interesting, but I didn't quite understand what they were getting at. If I could go back and replay the tape, that could lead to a better understanding, more depth for my coverage moving forward. It's also really helpful for Breakdown, our podcast, to be able to to record. And as for social media, talking about the depth that you can get into, I'm able to include little impressions in the courtroom that maybe wouldn't fit into a story. We call it color in the news business, but just little interesting details that I think really help humanize what's going on, provide a little more detail to our readers that I just think is helpful and interesting and drives engagement. And one last thing I will say, I've gotten plenty of nastiness from readers as a response to our coverage of the special grand jury. But one thing I have seen on social media is just how much people care and are paying attention. The depth that I'm completely surprised at the questions I get, how intelligent some of them are, how much people are following every twist and turn and really are trying hard to understand the process, and that's been really encouraging to me.
Mark, I'd like to ask you about the biggest news story of the Supreme Court's last term, and not just the overturning of Roe v. Wade, but the leak of the draft opinion in that case as well. So a couple of related questions. What was your reaction when you first saw the draft? And then what are the implications of the leak for coverage of the court? And what I mean by that is, will it change the way that journalists report on the court or the way that the public perceives the court?
Well, my first reaction was, I wasn't the recipient of the leak, so my first reaction was great upset. But you know, it was stunning in that we had, while the gist of decisions have leaked before, we have never seen an entire draft opinion leaked before, you know, just to sort of forestall any follow-ups. I don't know who leaked it, and I could give you I could talk to you all day of my theories of whether it was from the left or from the right or a clerk or justice. I just don't know what the answer is to that. Whether it will affect how the court is covered, I guess I'm, you know, the one thing that leak did was it confirmed what we all thought, And what we thought was based not just on the arguments, but what the court had done in a couple of related abortion cases in the fall. I mean, it was pretty clear that the court was going to at least uphold Mississippi's 15-week abortion ban, and probably, based on the argument, go ahead and overrule Roe. So in that sense, it wasn't a stunning surprise. It was just, not quite incontrovertible, but pretty strong evidence that was what was going to happen. I'm not sure how it's going to change reporting on the court, although I do think you're going to see more news outlets devote more manpower to, I guess, kind of like covering the ethics of the institution. I'm not quite sure where that's going to lead, and I don't expect that we're going to see, term after term with leak after leak, but I hope that's somewhat responsive.
It is. Tamar, this legislative session, we're seeing lawmakers weigh in on how the judicial branch can interact with them. Lawmakers have introduced rules that would make it harder for them to be subpoenaed, and they could debate a bill that would give the state the power to sanction prosecutors for shirking their duties and lower the threshold for recall votes. How could that impact relations between the political and judicial branches?
I mean, I think it'll further put pressure on those relationships and make it a lot harder to kind of depoliticize things. I mean, just last night, my colleague Mark Meese flagged me a brand new bill that was introduced in the state Senate in response to what we saw this last week with the four women of the grand jury stepping forward that would require grand juror secrecy, including for special grand juries, and create penalties for unauthorized disclosures of the process. So, I mean, it just goes to show that in this day and age, as partisanship kind of sinks its teeth into every institution, it's going to be really hard, even at the state level, to keep things depoliticized.
And then, Kathleen, with the increasing number of digital and non-traditional outlets that are covering the courts, including the Supreme Court of Georgia, has that ever posed credentialing challenges for the Supreme Court, in terms of drawing lines between who would get a credential, who would not?
So no, we don't actually credential reporters like I think maybe the House or the say House and Senate do. My view as PIO is that our courtroom is open. And so if you want to come observe oral argument in person, you are more than welcome to do that. The only thing I ask is if you're bringing a large group, let me know so we have seats. But that hasn't been an issue. And then in terms of media inquiries, if you're a member of the press and you're asking me for briefs or access to something, I'm going to give that to you. And, as long as it's not sealed records or you're asking, me for a legal opinion, I'm not a lawyer. Do not play one on TV. But no, I mean, I think it's interesting for me to watch on the side of things, kind of the change in platform and how reporters are going about sharing the news. But in my view, it's the same function. It's just in a different flavor.
Do you think that there are any unique challenges posed by working for a multi-member court? Where it's not just one justice who gets to
having nine bosses.
Yeah.
Yes. I mean, I think our court does very much operate collaboratively and cooperatively, but having the ability to see how things move through, it is very intentional. It is slow, but it's slow for a reason. And sometimes, as you can imagine, I've heard justices on tours kind of talk about their work as like an extended group project. Mm-hmm. And there may be some judges here who are willing to talk to you about that, but and sometimes they disagree on the law or interpretation. But in terms of public access, I think our court is very firm in that it is the public's business. The citizens of Georgia have a right to know how their government operates and have access to that. So I think there's a consensus there.
And Mark, you brought up the idea that the pandemic changed the way the reporters covered the U.S. Supreme Court. Could you elaborate on that a little bit and talk about what covering the court was like pre-pandemic, then during the pandemic, and now?
Well, the court, there's a certain enigma about the court. The justices aren't on television, and you don't see them that often. And so you know, the couple of dozen of us who are the regulars up at the Supreme Court are really the eyes and ears for the larger public. So that, as I was saying earlier, has changed. My fear had always been that once cameras or audio was available, that I would never get into the courtroom, and that would be a terrible thing because I'd have to essentially write about arguments as they were happening, and so I'd have to be at my computer listening and filing stories. And in fact, in some of the bigger cases, that is what happens. But it's not a terrible thing, I found. It's quite helpful. You know, the arguments these days are going much, much longer, sometimes more than 2 hours, where they used to be, you know, strictly an hour. And that's also pandemic related. And the effect of that for a news reporter is to make it harder, you know, to sort of like organize your thoughts and file a coherent story. But as we're able to take notes and file copy as the case is happening, it's worked out pretty well. And it, I think, serves a purpose in that, you're not having to wait for 4 or 5 hours after the event in this, you know, in this 24/7 era to hear about how the case is going or how it might come out or what justice says something particularly interesting.
Do you think the Supreme Court will ever allow cameras in their oral arguments?
I mean, ever. I assume so. I mean, I think certainly as long as Justice Thomas and Justice Alito are on the court, the answer is probably no. I mean, they have been among the most outspoken opponents of it. I mean, I think at some point, the younger justices seem much more at ease with the prospect and with technology, and I think it wouldn't be that surprising for me, and it's probably be another generation that would happen.
Okay. Well, I've been doing my best to watch the clock, and I'm afraid that we are out of time. So once again, thank you all for being here, and please join me in thanking the panelists for their time and sharing their perspectives.
We have a 10-minute comfort break. 10 minutes. Please be back right at the top of the hour, 11 o'clock sharp.
I tried to heckle you there for
me. Yeah, I didn't see you. So you came in straight.
I
see you
as well.
I should have given you a shout out.
What a fantastic day. A few items before we head to the reception. I want to again thank our sponsors. In particular, again, I want to thank the bar who make this space available to us, who give us so much support through the year. And again, for that fabulous parking. When you have the opportunity on your way out, please thank them. I also want to thank the planning committee members that have worked so hard to pull this event together. And there's one name at the top of the list there I want to thank. It's written in small type, so I've blown it up just a little bit. Peter Canfield is our planning committee chair. The first conference was in 1989. We skipped a couple of years, one very early, and then one after 9/11. But guiding this effort through the last 30 years, 30 conferences, has been Peter Canfield. It is his labor of love, corralling plenty of type A lawyers, judges, and journalists, getting them on a committee, getting them to work together towards a program that educates, informs, and challenges. We owe Peter a huge debt of gratitude. Please step up here for a moment. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's go get a drink.
It was helpful to us.
It's great to see you. I will be